Can I have, well, first, before we do roll call, I do want to mention we have two new people to our agency. We have Marie and Kelly, correct?
Yeah.
And they were voted in yesterday by the town council, so we're very happy that you're here with us today. And thank you for putting your names in and joining us. Okay, good, thank you. Can I have roll call, please?
Okay. Donna Corbin-Sabinski?
Here.
Kevin Zorba, absent. Virginia Higley, here. Robin Chagnon, absent. Jane Smith?
Here.
Carrie Ann Howe, absent. Marie Pisner?
Here.
And Kelly Hemler, I'm sorry.
Here.
Great. Okay. And I'd like to seat Marie for today. That means you can vote, because you're an alternate. Okay, so you'll be able to vote if you do any voting today. Fire evacuation procedures. If there's an emergency or whatever in the building or our room, obviously, you can exit the door to my left, go out and down the stairs and away from the building, or quicker way maybe to go through the back door and out and down the stairs and away from the building. Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. Public participation is next on the agenda. Is there anybody in the audience that would like to speak regarding items not on the agenda? Again, anybody want to speak regarding items not on the agenda? And one last time, anybody want to speak regarding items not on the agenda? Seeing none, we move forward. Next on the agenda is our correspondence. We were left with some draft meeting minutes from November 21st, but we did approve these at the last meeting, so don't think we need those. And other than that, that's all we received today.
I think you have December 5th minutes, don't you?
Yes.
In the package. Those were in our packet, so we're good with those. Thank you. Next on the agenda is the commissioner's correspondence. Does anybody have any ladies?
No.
Okay, great, perfect. Item 8 is approval of minutes from December 5th.
I can't do that. I wasn't here.
I'll move to accept the minutes of the last meeting, December 5th.
You can approve the motion. You can approve the motion.
You can second it.
Yeah. Second.
Okay, thank you. Okay, roll call, please. This is going to be tough.
Donna?
Yes.
Virginia, yes. Jane?
I have to abstain. I was not at last meeting.
Okay. Marie?
I had a chance to.
Oh, you're new. Sorry.
Abstain. Can't.
Okay.
Same with Kelly. So yep. I guess we have 2 in favor, 1 abstained. Is that correct? Okay. Motion passes. It's odd. sorry. Next on the agenda is new business. Under public hearings, we have IW number 585-0, King Street, application for proposed development consisting of 2 buildings, 500,225-square-foot distribution building of warehouse space and office space, and a 100,125-square-foot flex building. DF Realty LLC, owner applicant, map 16, lot 108, Industrial 1, I Zone, DOR 11717. Okay. And this is going to be a public hearing. So, Jenny, can you read the ad, please? So we want to open the public hearing.
Here.
Thank you. The commission will hold a public hearing on Tuesday, December 19, 2017, beginning at 7 p.m. in the Town Hall Council Chambers, 820 Enfield Street, concerning the following application, IW number 585. For 0 King Street, application for proposed development consisting of 2 buildings, 500,225-square-foot distribution building of warehouse space and office space, and a 100,125-square-foot flex building, DF Realty LLC owner/applicant. Dated the 7th day of December 2017, Donna Corbin-Sabinski, chairwoman. Information is available at the Enfield Planning Office. And it was advertised the Journal Inquirer December 7th and December 15th.
Thank you. Okay, so for the rules, just a little basic rules, the applicants will give their statements about the application, and the agents can ask questions and comments and that. We'll then hear statements from the people in the audience and the public. regarding any items on the agenda regarding the application. It can only be regarding inlands or wetlands. So if it's P&Z zoning type thing, we won't hear those. It's anything just regarding inlands or wetlands. Then the applicants will provide documents that they have sent certified letters to the,
correct,
which is fine, 15 days prior, whatever. So I guess that's pretty much the rules. So the applicants are seated. If you can give your name and address for the records.
Good evening. My name is Jeff Board. I'm a professional engineer in the state of Connecticut with BL Companies, located at 100 Constitution Plaza in Hartford, Connecticut. Here on behalf of DF Realty LLC, here with me tonight, I have Rachel Hyland, who's a project scientist at BL Companies, who's responsible for the wetlands assessment report in front of you this evening. And with me from DF Realty LLC is Mr. Mark Fontaine, who's in the audience as well. I would like to thank all of you for getting us on the agenda this calendar year before the holidays. It was very much appreciated from our time standpoint. And I'll head up to the board now to give you guys a brief overview on the site and get you oriented for the public as well.
Just one housekeeping rule. If there's something that you're presenting there that is not already in the record, we're going to have to mark it as an exhibit for the public hearing. So, like, the first item you have, is that in the packet somewhere? Or?
So that being said, this one is not in our packet, so I will mark this as exhibit E1.
So I have to stamp it.
Okay. Yep, not a problem. So exhibit E1 is essentially an existing conditions plan to orient the public, orient the commission as to the location. Oh, can you guys see this? Oh, you got it? Okay.
Yeah, so you have to tilt it towards the camera so the folks at home can see it and the audience can see it.
So essentially our project is technically 0 King Street. We're bordered to the north by Mullen Road and King Court. We're bordered to the south by the town of East Windsor town line. To the west by King Street, and ultimately I-91, and then to the east by another industrial use to our east there. Shown on here, basically we highlighted the existing property, which is 135.6 acres. On that property, there is a total of 32.6 acres of wetlands, and those are highlighted in blue on this map as well. So it kind of gives you a big picture overview. This is a very large site. There are a lot of wetlands on this site. And what we've done as we get into our presentation from a site plan standpoint is to try to minimize the disturbance within these areas as best we could. So that being said, there's also a water course on our site. It's Bowen's Brook. Ultimately, it's right down in this vicinity here. And water traverses over under I-91 and ultimately discharging into the Connecticut River. With that being said, I would like to introduce exhibit E2.
There's this one here.
Yep. Are there any questions on the orientation or where this is located? Okay. So what you have here is a colorized version of the site plan on top of an aerial exhibit. It's the site plan you have in your packages. All we've done is turned on the proposed landscaping and some of the drainage that's associated with the project. What we have is a 225,000 square foot distribution / flex building, warehouse building, and that's on the eastern side of the site. And on the west side of the site, we have a 100,125 square foot proposed distribution building / flex. Now, on the site as a whole, the 135.6 acres, we are proposing 495 passenger vehicles. We're required by code from the new regulations to have 481 passenger vehicles, so we do comply and we're over by 14 spaces. We are providing access points, two-way access, utilizing the existing driveway at Corporate Road. And then we're utilizing a new road that we're proposing that will be a private road to the north of our site.
Can I interject quickly? Yep. Do you know the reference of the site plan that is in our packages that you said is the colorized version of?
It should be SP0.
SP0? Okay. Yep. There's so many here.
There's a lot of pages. I apologize.
Thank you.
New members are probably nervous. This is what they're all like. But there's a lot of pages here. So essentially, as part of this, The driveways and roadways that go throughout are 32 feet wide. They do accommodate the tractor-trailer spaces that we are proposing, and part of the warehouse slash distribution is the fact that you provide a certain number of tractor-trailer stalls for an industrial use of this nature. So essentially, the two wetland crossings that we have, there's one up here on the new road on the north side, and then there's one crossing right in the middle here where the wetlands kind of close themselves off. So it's the area of least disturbance where we're crossing, and it's the only access point that we're providing into that 500,000 square foot building.
Now, point out because your book is blocking everything.
Not a problem. So essentially, from a snow removal standpoint, I know we have met with planning. It's kind of been a work in progress over the year. We prepared multiple alternatives as we went through this process, given the challenging nature of the site. Just given the environmental constraints, we did a lot of different concept planning and how to get an industrial building of this nature on the site in particular. There were several iterations of plans. We coordinated with the planner. We met with staff to go through and get some of their feedback early on in the summer. We incorporated some of those comments in here, and given the time of year, one of the big things that always comes up from a site circulation standpoint is the snow removal efforts. It's a very big thing in our book, and at this time of year, we always get the question. So what we did was we oversized a lot of the parking islands to allow for snow storage, essentially. And although we haven't delineated or signed the snow storage areas, a lot of times snow truck drivers won't acknowledge the signs, or we're willing to put them up. We're willing to designate areas that do not impact the stormwater BMPs. So that being the case, I would like to touch on stormwater a little bit. It's a little much to take in, and in your site plan packages, it's delineated by GD0 and the GD set of sheets. I'll give you a second, but there's 8 above ground detention basins as part of this application, and basically that's to mitigate the increase in impervious throughout the site. So part of the water quality measures that we're required to basically put forth are from the 2004 Connecticut Stormwater Quality Manual. And essentially those efforts include sediment forebays, grass filter strips, hydrodynamic separator units. There's 5 of them. Then there's 4-foot sumps in the catch basins with hoods and sweeping. So all that being said, you're required to do 80% TSS removal, or total suspended solids removal, by the regulations, which we do meet 100%. So we do comply with stormwater regulations, even given the new impervious that we are adding, and all of that is in the drainage report. One of the big things that we find is the fact that without managing these stormwater quality measures and without maintaining them, they basically don't function as they should. So what we always do is include an operations and maintenance plan for every one of the BMPs I described that basically gives the owner, developer, a sense on what needs to happen from a log standpoint, a maintenance standpoint, whether it's vacuuming out the catch basins, cleaning sediment in the basins themselves. So we are 100% compliant with stormwater regulations for the town of Enfield and the state. The other big thing to this, a lot of times when you add this much impervious, the concern is that you're going to generate a lot more stormwater runoff than you currently are. And we could say, given these 8 detention basins, we are reducing peak flows. We were sensitive not to reduce them too much so that they're still feeding the wetlands. We mimicked existing drainage patterns, so those won't be changing from existing to proposed. We did provide 2 box culverts that allow hydraulic connectivity between the two. So basically, water from the wetlands that's there today is still able to flow the way it was operating as it is now. Now, from a landscaping standpoint, we understand there's a lot of concern given the proximity to King Court. We do respect there is a 100-foot residential buffer basically along this property line and the back property line. What we did was we went ahead and provided a little bit more of that buffer. And part of the comments that came out from Roger and from the planning department were to supplement the landscaping that we did propose in this vicinity here and just add more to help that screening effect. There is a mature forest in place between there, but it is a little sparse in this area. So to add more landscaping, we're 100% in agreement to do so. On site, The good thing about this was that it was mostly disturbed farm fields or agricultural fields. So we're not doing too much removal from a standpoint of taking down trees. We are putting back, I think it was 100 and... It was 149 trees on site, and we're actually proposing 775 shrubs to basically complement in the buffers and help provide some of the buffer that we were basically taking away in those wetland areas. So basically, the good part about in this size building, there's a lot of invasives on site right now that as part of this development, we will be removing, cleaning up, and then planting back with native materials. So that will help those native materials flourish as opposed to what's out there today. From erosion control standpoint, the site is in compliance with the 2002 Connecticut Soil Erosion and Sedimentation Guidelines. There'll be silt fence around the perimeter, super silt fence at certain locations. There will be silt sacks at all the catch basins, concrete wash pits, everything that you could find in the erosion control guidelines. We are complying with 100% on this set of plans. Another big item that comes up, and it's for P&Z, sometimes wetland gets into it, is from a lighting standpoint, adjacent landowners want to know what the lighting is going to look like. We respect that. The light technology and lighting now for site lighting standpoint has come a long way in the sense that now they basically use LED, which are multi-directional lights with house side shields. So it basically limits the amount of light behind these fixtures. And we could say at the property lines, there's no light spillage coming off of a property, even though it's this large property. And those lights are mounted at 25 feet, which is pursuant to the Town of Enfield regulations.
So I think if I could, you're before the Wetlands Commission and you're talking about buffers and lighting and so forth, and I think really it would be good if it's going to be a long night if you mm-hmm. get involved with that, and maybe you could focus on wetlands and drainage and yep. stormwater.
Yep, that's not a problem. And like I said, the majority of this, we kind of came in with an application that was industrial in nature because there's been several applications before the town for previous applications for either a land use change. We've come in a couple times and they've gotten denied where they wanted to do kind of a mixed use application with residential, some industrial, and ultimately every time that that's happened, it's gotten denied. And we've been told that they want this to be an industrial site, which is what led us down this path over the last couple years, developing what we're at today. So with that, from a stormwater grading and drainage standpoint, I think I'm all set, and I'll turn it over to Rachel Highland.
Did you get our comment? Are you going to respond to them with
yes,
respect to stormwater and so forth?
Correct, I will, yep.
And particularly in the comments, we asked about the parcel that you had set aside, and it was unclear whether any of your calculations are taking into account that parcel, because you can't separate that as part of wetlands. That's all one parcel.
Yep, and our hydraulic calculations account for that whole parcel. So the only thing that's not accounted for in the bulk requirements, it would just improve our numbers if we include this piece. But from a hydraulic standpoint, a drainage standpoint, all those areas captured from that land are included in our calculations. Okay. And then from, I think the other comment was regarding the water quality information.
Right.
There's, I believe it's Appendix E of our drainage report. There's a good 20-something pages that has our total suspended solid calculations, water quality measures.
So is this site related to Costco at all?
It is not. That was a typographic error.
Because that was the comment that we had, is a lot of the information you talked about the Costco site, so we weren't really sure if the information you supplied applied to this site or not.
It applies to this site, and that was in one spot in the 490-page drainage report that it said Costco, so we're going to alleviate
right.
that when we make our resubmission.
But we would hope that you would present to the commission tonight, like we asked, where is your stormwater quality information, because it was our analysis behalf of the commission that a lot of your comments said, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, but then it was sort of not clear as to how you were doing it on your site.
We have 100% addressed water quality through the stormwater report,
yeah.
through our details.
That's all well and good to say it, sir, but I think this commission is going to want to know where are those structures and how do they relate.
Okay. Well, there's several structures throughout this. There's sediment forebays throughout. Basically in red on this picture, there's stormwater conveyance system. There's a series of catch basins, manholes that gets the water to these sub-watersheds in a post-development standpoint. And essentially, on each of those, there's inline water quality devices. So whether that be sediment forebays, whether that be the grass filter strips, whether that be the hydrodynamic separators, five of the basins do have these hydrodynamic separators, which remove in themselves the 80% total suspended solids. So all of those calculations were provided to the engineer for his review. They're 100% compliant from the water quality manual. So from that standpoint, there's not much more we can do. The water's coming out cleaner, you know, than the regulations even allow us to have to do.
I know they also questioned the flow back into the brook and the floodplain.
So basically with that comment, we are reducing those flows by holding back with outlet control structures in each of these eight basins. So the flows that are coming out from an existing standpoint today in those sub watersheds, we're matching or mimicking the existing patterns that are out there and holding back the water with those outlet control structures to account for the additional impervious. And then those waters are released at lesser of a rate than they're there now. So from that standpoint, it'll be less than it is today.
I know another question what they had was you were going to pave over 2.9 acres of the soil, wetlands?
It's 2.39. 2.39, which equated to roughly, I think, 7% of the total wetlands on site. Mm-hmm. So basically that is correct. And Rachel will get up. We have an exhibit that shows the areas of the wetland, which the majority of that 2.39 acres is actually in the disturbed agricultural field that exists there.
We'll see what she talks.
I was going to say, what about the creating, offsetting that?
Yeah.
That will be on.
That's going to be part of her discussion.
It'll be on the next. We do have some. We do have some areas.
Another discussion they had was the 5.10 acres of the site was reserved as a separate parcel.
Yep, that was this vicinity right down here. This is number three. Yep.
Is that what's noted as the proposed lot area?
Basically down here, they carved this parcel out. They're not going to include this as part of our bulk requirements. So in all of our numbers and like our setbacks and impervious numbers, this lot has been excluded. If we add this back into the bulk requirements, it essentially just makes our site better because this is all just lawn area and forest right now. We're not touching any of it. So all it would do would improve our numbers. Their concern was mostly from a hydraulic standpoint, a drainage standpoint. This parcel, as Roger alluded to, and he's correct, it contributes water in existing conditions to this system. So it is part of our design. So this area has been captured in our drainage report. And that was the bigger concern.
So the calculations do include that area then?
The calculations from a stormwater the calculations from a stormwater standpoint include this area. The bulk requirements, which basically are your lot coverage and your building coverage, which will only improve if we were to add that.
Okay, so it's only from the bulk.
Only for the drainage, which is what they were concerned about.
Okay. Well, my comment was is that you can't create a subdivision by a wetland approval. So you would have to go subdivide the land first and then come back or show it as a subdivision or something.
And for our purposes tonight, the easiest way to handle it when we do address these comments on plan changes would to just be include this parcel as part of this application and then, as he alluded to, come back to subdivide it out in the proper manner. It won't impact any of the numbers you're looking at tonight, and it will just be included and improve them in anything. Think so.
My name is Rachel Highland. I'm a project scientist at BL Companies, and I'm going to go through the wetlands. There's quite a bit on the site. So we have seven wetlands total that we've divided out. For the most part, they're interconnected, but we just gave them numbers to try and be able to describe them a little bit better. So our biggest systems
I say for the record that your submittal, you had three different wetland soil scientists providing things. You might want to just say what it is you did as opposed to what it is other people who are not here presenting did. Because there were three different soil scientists who submitted information.
Yes. So we had Ed Pollock do the first delineation last December. He felt that his delineation may have been compromised in some way. So we had a second soil scientist go out and verify the boundaries. He ended up extending the boundaries in some areas. And I believe while Ed was out there, he also had a second opinion from another soil scientist about this central wetland because the soils were very disturbed due to the agricultural use. So he wanted to get a second opinion before he decided it was or was not wetland soils. So I am not a soil scientist and therefore cannot complete a wetland delineation in Connecticut. I'm very well versed in wetlands though. So I did the assessment. I wrote the report that you guys are going to be reading or have already read. So like I said, we divided them into eight different wetlands, even though they're all essentially the same system, all contributing to Bowen's Brook down at the southern portion of the site. So starting from the west to the east, we'll talk about what I believe I called this one Wetland 1. It's one of our more disturbed areas in that the entire edge.
What page are we on?
Was it another exhibit that he marked as E3?
Okay, so we don't have it.
But it should be essentially the existing site plan with the wetlands. It's just that they're colored in.
When you come back for the second public hearing, you have to have the information into the staff so the staff can review it before you present it. The rules of the commission normally don't allow you, but since we're not going to take any action tonight, it's okay. But you have to submit it and in time for the various departments, such as the town engineer and the planning office, to review it.
So we have the western wetland, which is rather disturbed along the boundaries.
Can we see this thing?
I'm sorry? Can you see it if I point like this?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the western wetland. The entire boundary along its eastern portion consists of some really nasty invasives. We've got a lot of multiflora rose, autumn olive, non-native invasive honeysuckle bushes that have just formed this really dense covering to the east, making it very hard to get in there. So that's what this 100,000 square foot building is going to be impacting the most, is this wetland. And for the most part, we got lucky that there are so many terrible invasives sitting there. So a little bit more about this system in general. There's a bit of a drainage path that trickles through the wetland, and then it outlets down here at a pipe that takes it under Corporate Road. So they've maintained the drainage patterns. I'm sorry if I'm blocking it. And they're going to put in a box culvert to allow the water to naturally drain down that way and continue the same drainage pattern. Moving to the east, we have a wetland up here that is going to be not touched. It's not part of the impacts. Then we've got a long finger wetland that kind of narrows down right around here. And then it goes through a pipe under a farm road and then just kind of continues as a swale with a water course that continues down through another pipe and then discharges to Bowen's Brook. As Jeff already said, they've chosen this area as the road because it's already so narrow. There's already a pipe there. They'll have to replace it, obviously, but it's the area of least impact. So that'll be account for some of the impacts to this wetland, or to both wetlands. I believe I might have called them out as two different numbers. Then we have a very large wetland system here as well that connects in to this area right here, a very narrow connection right there. And for the most part, this is the disturbed farm field where they had to get a second opinion on the soils. It seems to be fairly recently utilized. I believe there was still corn left over when I was out there in May. So it's very disturbed. It's not providing much native cover, so it's not really habitat. It's still providing some functions and values, such as sediment retention and nutrient attenuation, but for the most part, I would classify it as highly disturbed. Moving to the east, we have the largest wetland system on site, which is mainly a forested wetland with some pockets of emergent and scrub shrub cover. And it all just kind of interconnects with Bowens Brook and several other intermittent water courses or perennial water courses that flow through these areas. There are some areas of pooled water over in this area. And so that's a pretty broad general overview about the wetlands. A little bit more information while we were out there. We did come across some vernal pools. There were 6 in total, I believe. Several of them consist essentially of just tire ruts that get inundated, and amphibians decided it was a good place to lay some eggs. Unfortunately, I did return in the summer, and several of the very tiny wetlands appear to dry out before the end of the season. It's my opinion that in any given normal season, not a lot is making it out of those pools alive. It doesn't give them quite enough time to develop. So I would say that it's the pools right around here, this one, and this one are probably the 3 least productive pools on site. There is a relatively nice pool right here that is ponded for most of the year, which is a little bit abnormal for a vernal pool as they normally dry out, but there were salamander and wood frog larvae in there, and then this is another vernal pool that we're not going anywhere near, and it's much more productive. So that's a brief overview about the resources on site. And then I guess I'll just go into impacts really quickly. I don't want to bore everyone with exact numbers, but if you have questions, I can certainly answer them. I'm sorry, I'll put that there. So we have impacts to wetland 1, wetland 3, 4, and 5. So that would be this area right there, right here, right there, and right there. We're avoiding the 4 remaining wetlands, which are some smaller pockets, as well as this one, and the majority of the really large wetland system. The total impacts are going to be 104,030 square feet, which equals about 2.39 acres. And then we also have upland review impacts, which we detailed as well in the report. So that's a brief overview about all they're planning on doing. I did provide buffer plantings for some areas where we felt that we could provide plantings to supplement around wetlands. We tried to stay out of the wetlands to avoid any further, you know, temporary impacts. We could plant in the wetlands along edges if you would like us to. But for now, I just wanted to kind of offer plantings in areas that are adjacent to wetlands and adjacent to work. And in those areas, we planted native shrubs that will offer some value, such as wildlife habitat, food, and we also did conservation or wet seed mixes that'll offer nutrient attenuation, sediment trapping, and things like that once they're established. I think that's mostly it for me. If you have any questions.
And one thing I forgot to mention as well is not only do we have to go to the state for wetlands, but there are federal wetlands on here. So we will be going through the exercise of coordinating with Army Corps of Engineering to go through their permitting process as well. So as Rachel said, there are areas on site where we can provide wetland mitigation, but ultimately we'll have to go to Army Corps. And a lot of times they want an in-lieu fee in place of creating wetlands on site. That's not to say that you guys couldn't ask for, and we have the room to do certainly one-to-one mitigation on a site this size. So
in your book on page 17, if that's all right,
go ahead.
On you say, Rachel, given the large area of the site and presence of non-native species, there appears to be opportunities for wetlands enhancement and mitigation, which will be coordinated with the regulatory agencies. And as I understood, the first presenter tonight, he said you were going to tell us what you would offer the commission in terms of that 2.39 acres that you're paving over, but I didn't hear you present anything.
I wanted to kind of get your input before we really presented very much, because...
Well, that's the responsibility of the applicant is what I'm saying. It's not up to the board to say this is what you have to do. Your responsibility is to say we're paving over wetlands. This is what we're going to do.
Okay.
And then the commission evaluates what you're going to do. And the first presenter tonight said you would tell us what you could do.
We do have a number. We have a number prepared.
So essentially, what's in yellow up there on the right-hand side, and I'll point it out just for the benefit of the public.
Yeah, because I can't see that.
There's these two areas right in this vicinity here and here that are essentially upland review areas right now.
You're talking to the...
I was just going
to
show both.
You're talking.
And then this one. So this space right here, and then this right here, basically total 3.73 acres. So we're only disturbing, so that small area of the large site we have, that was providing 3.73 acres of potential wetland mitigation, as we called it, because we do have to go to Army Corps, we do have to go through their permitting process, and sometimes just to create wetlands and kind of disturb an upland review area that also has functions to a wetland gets a little dicey. So there's several opportunities. The client is certainly willing to replace what we're taking away at a one-to-one, if not more. And then as we go through Army Corps, we will be doing even additional measures on top of that. So these were the couple of areas that we felt were least obtrusive to adding back wetlands, and it was over an acre and a half above what we're taking away. And that leaves all the other upland areas intact, but that was just our first engineering effort that would be the path of least resistance that machinery could exit to create wetlands.
So you're going to add it back to the upland review area?
Well, it would be areas adjacent to the wetlands that we have access to for construction equipment to be able to create wetlands and provide wetland plantings within that vicinity.
Yeah, that yellow area is.
Gotta use your mic.
Can you just clarify those yellow spots again? Is that's where you are proposing that new wetlands would be put in place?
Yeah, so essentially what we're showing on this plan in the red is basically what we're basically impacting. We're permanently impacting what's shown in red here. And that totaled the 2.39 acres, as Rachel alluded to. What we showed in yellow was our first attempt, prior to going to Army Corps, of where we could potentially provide wetlands. And that square footage, just on our first go-around of this, was roughly 3.73 acres. So it was an exercise to show that we can easily, on site, create 2.39 acres of wetlands.
Okay, and how is that relative to the existing wetlands that are on the site already?
The existing wetland actually follows this line right here.
So
we're just creating, we're making this area larger.
So basically the flag would go cut it across the top then?
Correct.
Gotcha. Okay.
And there's several opportunities to do that all over, but.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there's lots of spaces on the site to do that.
There is. So it should be no problem to get the one-to-one
mitigation. We don't have that copy here, so I'm just going to match that to this. So
can we get a copy of that?
Yes. I'll leave this here, and I can send electronic copies as well and make a submission with our next resubmission addressing comments if we do get any from engineering and the planning comments.
I understand through Roger that the landscaping is the applicant's responsibility. Mm-hmm. Perhaps if you have any concerns or questions, you could give us choices. You know, it's totally up to you. But you know, if you feel strongly about getting our input, perhaps you could give us one or two choices.
Yep. And we have a landscaping schedule that has all the tree choices that we did pick. However, we would be open to suggestions. They are native species that we chose, but we are certainly open to swapping them out for any recommendations you guys may have or have had success with on other projects.
I don't know if you've had a chance to look at the landscaping plans. Did you? Okay. I was going to say I can tell you what species we've got. Well, if you'd like, I can go over them really quickly.
In the parking lot landscaping, as I pointed out for the benefit of the two new commissioners, your parking lot landscaping is, you say you don't meet the requirements of zoning, and there's no discretion in the zoning code. You have to meet it. So what you proposed is, assuming you got through wetlands, would not pass when you got to PNZ. So you're going to have to beef up the landscaping.
Yep.
Well, we're not looking at the landscaping. We're just looking at the wetlands plants.
She mentioned wetland there was plantings. Potential wetlands
I heard you to say landscaping, Commissioner.
Oh, no.
My bad.
Sorry.
No, we just wanted some clarification of where the potential proposed wetlands plantings would be.
Oh, okay. So we haven't, I haven't planted those wetlands just yet, but if you wanted some verification on the wetland buffer plantings, I can certainly provide you that right now.
And which plan?
It is WB-0.
WB-0.
Yeah, it's a wetland buffer planting plan.
That makes sense.
One of the issues was in trying to follow your plans is that you listed species on one set of maps and then you gave the symbols but on another set of maps, so you had to look at the symbol and then go back to another map. It would be very helpful if you listed the species and the symbols on the same map.
We saw that comment. We will add it to every landscape sheet that there's 8 of them.
All right, so I think everyone's on the page now. So just to give you an idea of why these plants were chosen, as for the trees, we did eastern cottonwood and American elm. Those are species that are already present out at the site. If it's not fixed, if it's not broke, don't fix it. So we could obviously add different species to beef up diversity. However, I chose those because I know that they work there. As for the shrubs, we had sweet fern, which is a shorter bush, silky dogwood and gray dogwood. I chose the two different because silky dogwood is a little bit better in wetter areas. Witch hazel, which is really good in the shade. Winterberry, obviously for its berries. Highbush blueberry, the same, and then northern arrowwood. All these plants do pretty well along wetland buffers, so that's why they were chosen. But plants that do better in wetter conditions, I placed closer to the wetlands.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Very good choices.
Thank you. If you have anything you want to add or take away, just let me know.
I just didn't see this at the time.
Okay. Also, as far as mitigation goes, we didn't want to go too crazy with adding wetlands all over the site, not because that's a bad thing, but because once you add all the wetlands to the site, you're left with very little upland then. And of course, the upland habitat is very important as well. So that's, again, why I wanted to get some input of where you feel the wetland mitigation would be best, which uplands you felt need to be preserved the most. I can obviously make my recommendations and have my opinions, but I didn't want to go too crazy and get too far and then have someone really disagree.
Well, I think you're certainly on the right track with those ones that are up in the corner where you're like cutting off an area where there's wetlands on either side anyway and creating that whole area, just call it all wetlands. Yeah, it makes sense because there's not much you can do in between those wetlands anyway. So you might as well have it all designated as such, and then it's not an issue. So those would certainly be the types of areas that I would recommend looking for adding and getting to that 1-to-1 ratio, which, of course, is sort of standard practice.
Okay. Did we have any... Okay. Anybody else have any comments? Any... Okay, so I guess now we could refer to the public and see if they have any questions or whatever. Do we have a sign-up sheet, Roger?
Wait, do we have a...
I thought I saw... There was a maintenance one while they're coming up. There's a maintenance plan on here somewhere, right? I think I saw it.
I saw it once, but I can't remember which site plan it's on.
So we have some people here that would like to speak regarding this application. And first is Michael Shaw, 29 King Court.
Can everybody hear me?
You got to use the microphones?
You have to sit down.
You have to sit down and use a mic.
Retired First Sergeant, Army Engineer.
Oh, nice.
Oh, great.
A lot of buddies in the Corps.
You're on TV.
Yeah, okay.
Smile for the camera.
I'm here seriously. Now, can everybody hear me?
There you go.
Okay, first, I'd like to say I'm a resident of that street, and we live in Rice Fields. depending on what time of year they come and take wetland studies, you can have up to your boots, your knees, or dry. It depends on, does it rain a lot? Did the vegetation not grow as good as last year? What keeps back the wetlands in our neighborhood on King Court is the deciduous vegetation, the hardwood trees. Without that, we all be underwater. Those poor people that live at the end of the street, they can grow rice 7 months a year. It's that bad. They even put storm drains down the end to help them out a little bit. When a scientist came up and pointed to that map, what did she say? There's a lot of wetlands there. It's all wetlands. It's all wetlands. They're trying to build something like a shoehorn, fit it right into what we're doing there. And if you're the Wetlands Commission, when you hear someone make a comment like that, it's all a lot of wetlands there. There's a problem there. I have other issues with safety, with noise, but we're going to discuss wetlands. I live on the other side of the street. I live on the odd side. We have wetlands behind us. We have a buffer forest that keeps it at bay. It rains heavy, a lot of snowpack. My yard isn't dry till August. And that's on the other side of the street. Yeah, if you put the other map up, I'll show you. All right. I live in the middle of the street. My house is on a slab, and there's a reason why my house is on a slab. Wetlands all around there. I'm surprised they let you build houses there. But the houses at the beginning of the street have basements with sump pumps. I'm on a slab where I see the water splash up against my slab certain times a year. That's on this side. On the other side, they have the same problems. And the people out here can attest to it. They can raise their hands. They know what's going on there. When they say there's lots of wetland there, there is a lot of wetland, and they're going to disturb a lot of it. And if you think that they can mitigate it and minimize what's going on there, then it's your job to say, well, that's okay. But when they say there's a lot of wetlands, and the other guy says, we'll do the best we can, that's not right. It's not the best we can. It's fitting it in properly, not with a shoehorn. And that's all I have to say tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Linda Gary, 32 King Court.
Good evening. I also echo Mike's comments. If you only knew the parcel of property that they're speaking of, it does not belong in that area. I live at 32 King Court, and this will be my backyard. For 20 years, we have lived in this house. We've enjoyed this property. We bought because it was on a dead-end street. Our backyard overlooked the field. We enjoy the wildlife, and you're stripping it all away, all to cram a warehouse into wetlands. That is the common theme. Wetlands, wetlands, it is not to be developed. Are we gonna have another Fermi on our hands? 10, 20 years, these people are gonna be gone, but we're gonna be living here with this remnant in our backyard. You plant all these bushes and trees, but it's still gonna be light in our backyard, in our bedrooms. The animals that are living there, you're pushing them away. We haven't even discussed the traffic, the tractor trailers. We all know the condition Mullen Road was, and they're proposing over 200 tractor trailers and 500 cars going down these private roads and Route 5. It cannot handle that. There's so many other locations of vacant properties. Take your pick in other surrounding towns, even within Enfield. Look at Hartford. They're trying to develop Hartford. Perhaps that is a more suitable proposal for this warehouse. And I believe the others who are here from King Court will support what both Mike and I and the other people will be speaking, how this proposal does not belong in our backyard. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Joanne Cadron. Did I say that right? I'm sorry if I didn't. 28 King.
Pretty close.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, my name is Joanne Cadrain. Okay. I've lived at 28 King Court for over 40 years. I raised my two sons. It was a wonderful place to live. If I sit on my deck and look out into my backyard and into the wetlands, I have got a list of animals that come by and visit me every week, including a bobcat. I had 30 turkeys in my yard last week. Deer, coyotes, fox, all types of birds. I've got hawks that have a family that at the end of my property, they've living up in the trees. Fisher cats, possums looking in my windows. And that's why myself and my family and my friends love it so there. Also, in July and August, I cannot mow my grass because it is soaking wet. The kids will go out to play, and they'll come in, and they're soaked up past their ankles. I'm very dismayed and very upset that this has even come to this. Who wants to now sit? And where are these animals going to go? Where are they going to go? I'm just very distressed. The thought of having tractor trailers, buildings in the backyard, animals will be gone. It doesn't work. It's not going to work. And I just hope everybody gives this a lot of thought. Thank you.
There. Next is Nathan Carl, 30 King Court.
Hello, my name is Nathan Carl. I live at 30 King Court. Everybody that has come up thus far lives at the peak of the street, basically where the basements end. And I've only lived in my house for 10 years, but I have seen the cycle changes that have been noted. The first year we moved in, I tried to mow the lawn, and I learned very quickly that you can't do that early in the year. And some years I have been able to mow earlier in the year because the wetlands just seem to fluctuate that much in that area. I have more concerns about the tractor trailers and everything that will be, as was stated, in my backyard. I think most of us enjoy King Court and move to King Court because it is a quiet residential cul-de-sac that
yes,
sits.
Sir, this is to the Wetlands Commission, and the P&Z would take up tractor trailers.
When will that meeting be?
Well, it would have to find out what this commission does with it first.
Okay.
If this commission doesn't see fit to pass it, it never gets to P&Z.
Okay.
But the charge of this commission is the impact on the wetlands. So, you know, anything that you could say with respect to the wetlands would be germane.
Okay. So the effect of the facilities that will be placed on the wetlands will drive out that nice, quiet residential neighborhood that is there because of the wetlands. When we moved in, that was one of the things that brought us there, was how quiet it was, the nature that was right outside our back door. And I'd hate to see that leave. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Next is Doris Akay. Probably got that wrong. 6 King Court.
Hi, my name is Doris Akay, and I live at 6 King Court. That's all right. It's better than Akay. Anyway, I guess I can't, since I can only talk of wetlands, I only have to repeat what Mike said, what Joanne said. And I think you can realize that this is one terribly large footprint that we're putting on this area. And it's, if it was a building that was never going to do anything, okay. An office building, never do anything. But you got to think of the other things that this place is going to promote. So I'm just reiterating that please think about this. This is a very, very delicate area. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody else in the audience that would like to speak that didn't have the opportunity? Is there anybody in the audience that would like to come back for a second time?
No? I'll just say one more thing.
Okay.
The next time I see you.
Look, come to and say your name and address for the record, please.
Yes, my name is Michael Shaw. I live at 29 Kings Court in Enfield. And the next time I come to see you guys, I'm going to bring my geodetic survey map. It shows elevation and it shows wetlands on it. And you'll see that map was nonpartisan, made by someone who had no interest in anything. And you'll see what's happening there. And it's a 30-year average, so it's a better grade. You can trust that. And I'll have that next time. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else that would like to speak? Okay, seeing none. Would the applicant like to come back?
We would like to say thank you for your time. We want to address their concerns, and we will look to do so. I know we're going to be, and it's hard to understand the level of complexity with this drainage system. There's a lot to it. And to just for me to get up there and just say we're reducing peak flows to someone who lives there, it's personal. It means a lot, and it means a lot to us as a designer to ensure that we are providing additional or reducing the peak flows coming off the site, that we would be mitigating and certainly respecting the town's regulations as far as residential buffers. We're over 100 feet on all residential property sides. So from our standpoint and the developer's standpoint, the fact that they want to have this as a true industrial site, the footprint, although large, is the kind of footprint you would need to develop on a parcel like this in order to make it economically feasible for one person to come in. And if not, it kind of renders the site undevelopable from that standpoint. And what they did, which was coincidentally enough, they had a mixed use development that was on the site, I want to say 10 years ago, 8 years ago, wasn't before a whole different group of people, for mixed use residential and I think it was industrial as well. It got approved through Wetlands, and it was basically eliminate or permanently filling in the wetlands that we're filling in as well. And this footprint does exactly that, and the other areas of the footprint that we've tried to utilize were in that disturbed agricultural field. So we understand the how personal this is from a wetland standpoint, that some of the properties over there can be wet. Ours are secluded from theirs in the sense that we are 100 feet away from that boundary and maintaining a vegetated buffer in between. And there's no low points along the property line where we're not hydraulically connected to their wetlands on the other side of the street. So we certainly understand the frustration. We understand the size of this. And we also understand that to get industrial on this site, this is what's culminated over the last 2 years.
And I would just like to add really quickly, when we're talking about wetlands, for anyone who may not be aware, wetlands in this case are fulfilling all three requirements. They have hydric soil, hydrophytic vegetation, and hydrology. That's the federal standard. The state standard is just soil. Like we've said, we've had two different wetland scientists review the entire site, and these are the lines that they came up with. So we're confident in those areas. There might be areas where it seems very wet, but it's not meeting the criteria. So that's what I'm talking about when I say wetlands. So I just wanted to let anyone who wasn't aware know.
And coincidentally enough, a lot of times when we do projects like this and we go out and get a soil scientist, we'll have one soil scientist who comes out at a certain time of year. And to the public's credit, if you do that, you're not seeing the whole picture, and sometimes it can be convoluted. In our case, it was almost not a blessing for our client, but from a wetland standpoint, the fact that he thought some of his flags had been moved or tampered with, we felt it in our obligation, just from an ethics standpoint, to have somebody go back out there, redelineate these wetlands. They did get much bigger in footprint, so the original gentleman who delineated it was correct. And these were done at two completely different times of year. I believe one was done early winter, late fall,
December,
and then I believe the other was done in April or May, so in the springtime. So we did get to see two seasons, as opposed to just the one that we typically get when we do a development of this nature.
And just to sort of clarify, the general flow of the wetlands is north to south, right? Towards
correct.
Bowens Brook, so away
correct.
From King's Court.
Correct.
So the peak flows that immediately you reduce them isn't actually going to change anything on the King's
It will
Court.
Not. And that's, in fact, the high side on the northwest corner. So everything kind of just starts to flow down. So anything we are generating and providing into these basins ultimately discharge down to Bowens Brook and not anywhere near their direction.
I really have a question for the commission and the applicant, but given the fact that you have unanswered questions that you need to put together and they have to be in 10 days prior to the next meeting, and the next meeting is in 2 weeks, which will not give the staff time to review them, I think we're looking at the second meeting in January for a continuance. And I will just say that I would think that you need to make a much more in-depth presentation. The presentation tonight where you simply say you meet everything but you don't demonstrate, the commission will want to get involved. And I haven't seen the commission take a report from a wetlands person in training without having a soil scientist here that could be cross-examined. So you may think about bringing a soil scientist to your next meetings who prepared the report so that they could be cross-examined. So those are just my suggestions. So at this point, I would suggest to the chair that you figure out when that second meeting in January is and perhaps have a motion to continue it until that meeting. As long as it's not more than 35 days from now, we'd be all right. We don't need an extension. If it is more than 35 days, we're going to need an extension from the applicant to hold open the public hearing.
I move to extend the public hearing to the second meeting in January, which would be January 16, 2018.
Second.
Okay, can I have roll call, please?
Sorry about that. Okay. Donna?
Yes.
Regina?
Yes.
Yes.
Marie?
Yes.
And Kelly, you could say yes, too.
Yes. 5 in favor, motion passes. So we'll extend the public hearing to our second meeting in January, which is January 16th.
Thank you, guys. Have a great holiday.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Was there not discussion about having Wednesday meetings in January?
Yeah. We haven't, yeah.
Was that later on? Okay.
Yeah. We just but now it's going to be Tuesday.
Yep, we just meet downstairs.
That's all. It'll be. Give everybody a chance to get settled before I continue. Sir?
Yes.
You talked about giving us an elevation. Could you get it to the town before?
Could you get it to Roger?
I'll drop here and I'll highlight things for you.
Okay. Yes, yeah. That'd be perfect. Perfect. So we could get it in our packets.
Yeah, what you said about
No, no, we just asked if we could.
Need to go to you.
Yeah. Okay, thank you everybody for your comments, and we'll continue on for that for the January 16th. And we'll continue our agenda, which is applications to be received. Item 10, it's XIW 17-19, Town Farm Road Reconstruction, application for new drainage and road reconstruction. Town of Enfield applicant owner. Did we actually get it? We haven't seen those.
No. And they were, Jen put them on here. We only just received them within the last 2 days in the office. We haven't even looked at them yet. So technically they're official as of tonight, but we're going to have to review them and get them out to you.
For our next meeting?
Yeah. So you'll have them, but whether you take them up in that, well, let's see. You could take
Probably
them up 16th. At the January 2nd meeting.
Yeah.
They're town road reconstruction
right.
projects,
yeah,
which you guys
very
have got.
Thorough, yeah.
You're in a rhythm on those.
Yeah, they do a very good job.
Yeah.
So, that'll be fine. And we will receive application XIW 17-20 Bridge Lane Road Reconstruction. It's an application for rehabilitation reconstruction road project. There's also the third one is XIW 17-21 Thompsonville Northeast Road Reconstruction, an application for reconstruction and reclaim of the roadways within the project area of Dover Road, Foxcroft Road, Montana Road, Leonard Road, Fremont Road, and Eleanor Road, Town of Enfield. So those will be received or officially received tonight for our next meeting. Next on the agenda is a determination of permit need, which seeing none. Reports of officers and committees, we have none. Report from the planning director.
Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah.
Thank you.
Happy New Year.
To your staff as well.
Welcome to the new members.
Yes. Thank you. And item 14 is old business. It's our calendar date. And I don't think we have any.
You don't have enough people here to decide, so I think we're going to file your regular calendar and we'll continue to discuss it until such time as you get a full complement.
You're going to file of the regular calendar for Tuesdays, right?
Right. Yeah.
For Tuesdays?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Well, in January, it gets bumped both days to Wednesday.
Right, right. Because January.
Because the council, it's a holiday, both. Yep. January 1st goes to the 2nd, and Martin
they
Luther King
to,
Day
yep.
moves
but
it.
But we're always downstairs.
So we could go on meet on the Tuesday on the same
we
night downstairs.
We have a public hearing downstairs, though, for the 16th. We're going to want to move that one.
Oh, yeah, but why would we want the second one? What's the...
Well, no, the issue becomes that Public Access TV has to have a second crew to do both of them, and they've asked that we don't have Wetland and Council the same night in terms of requiring it. So that was my understanding as to why you guys get bumped.
We've always had it downstairs.
Yes.
Not on the same night.
Yeah,
always.
We just told these applicants to come back on the 16th, which is a Tuesday.
Well, you know, we'll deal with it.
That would be downstairs? Or
Can't we have it downstairs on the 16th?
Yeah,
you know,
it should be fine.
We continue to the 16th. We'll deal with it on the 16th.
Yes, it'll be fine downstairs.
Okay.
It'll be fine downstairs.
Yeah.
Okay, so we will do that.
Having had ZBA last night, you guys tonight, P&Z on Thursday night, I'm focused on finishing this year out.
There you go. Worry about January later.
Marathon, man.
That's right. Great. Adjourn?
Go ahead. You do that.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Meeting's adjourned. Thank you very much. Okay.